good to have you with us on the 9 p.m. edition of the Urban Debate. Viewers, one more time, we are going to put the spotlight on the National Education Policy. The National Education Policy that was approved by the government earlier this week. Now, it's an exhaustive vision document, essentially, of how our education system, especially for schools, but even for colleges, how the education system should evolve over the next 10 to 15 years. Some of the ideas are meant to be implemented in the next couple of years, some of them 5 years later. The big plan is to increase the spending on education, open it up for more private players to ensure that there are more options available to the students, streamline the process, reduce the stress of exams, and a lot more. And with the first round of the conversation we did last evening, today, I want to specifically pick up one issue. Now, as we have discovered, this isn't a new proposal, but it's a controversial one. And it's one that now a lot of people are again talking about. It's the proposal for using your local language or mother tongue as a medium of instruction. Not just to learn the language. Don't get the two things mixed up. It's to use your local language as a medium of instruction to teach children up to grade 5, possibly till grade 8. Now that's a lot. Essentially what they're proposing is that if you are in Maharashtra, then the schools here till class 5th will teach you everything in Marathi. If you are in Tamil Nadu, you may be from Tamil Nadu, you may be from Kerala, you may be from Maharashtra, Uttar Pradesh, or even Kashmir. But the schools there may start teaching you every subject. The language used to impart education would be Tamil. Now that sounds good to a certain extent, because the basic assumption is, and the experts say, it's because children adapt things faster and easier in their mother tongue or in the language that they're comfortable, which is usually their mother tongue, whatever is spoken at home. And so this would help children grasp things faster. While this as a concept, I believe, works very well in many other countries across the world, especially in the West, I don't think it will be easy to implement this in our country. I think it could get dangerous. And I will tell you why. Point number one, we are a diverse country. We have hundreds of languages and dialects across the country. And we move around a lot. We work in one state, we are born in another. We get married in another, change houses, change jobs. We get into a job which is a transferable one. And you move across the country because it is one nation, irrespective of what language we speak. So how is it that those who are in a transferable job, how will their children adapt to this kind of a change? What about those whose mother tongue may be something else, but they may have settled in another state altogether? So a child with Tamil parents may be used to only listening to that language at home, but when he goes to school, he may have to actually be schooled in Gujarati or Hindi. Does it make it difficult or easy for that child? And who's going to help this small group of people? All right to say that the majority won't have this problem, but in our country, our policies can't be decided only on the basis of what the majority thinks is right. There are a lot of other issues that I feel we will have. I fear that this could end up becoming simply a political tool. So in the run-up to a state election, a party stands up and says, oh, we're all for our mother tongue and we're going to push this language, and that's what's going to happen, without really implementing the options for those who may not be comfortable with this idea or the language. And what happens when you suddenly reach sixth standard and your syllabus increases, the kind of things that you are studying become more difficult, and you have to do all of that in a new language, in a language that so far was only one of the many things you were learning. And suddenly everything has to be understood in English. Won't it be more hard then? These are my thoughts and my questions. Let's open it up for conversation. Let's say good evening to Mr. Binoy Viswa, Member of Parliament of the Rajya Sabha, joining me this evening. Lata Vaidyanathan, educationist, Shweta Shalini of the BJP, Anjali Razdan, Chief Education Advisor for GD Goenka School, and Dr. M.K. Sridhar, Member of the National Education Policy Drafting Committee. And Dr. Sridhar, let me begin with you. Dr. Sridhar, there are some reports that suggest that initially the proposal was to make Hindi the medium of instruction. But since certain states objected to it, especially from the south, it was agreed upon that let's just make it the local language. Would you be able to shed more light on this?
This policy is the third national education policy. First in 68, then 86 and this. There is already a particular kind of a policy with regard to languages. That is a three language formula. So this policy very clearly emphasizes the continuation of the policy. So there is nothing that we changed, but very important that we try to look at is the child. The literacy and the language is a very, very important component. So that learning has a lot of impact because of that. We need to give emphasis on multilingualism that starts from local language to international language. And we need to have an ecosystem which will facilitate picking up and transacting in as many languages as possible. This is the basic approach of our policy. So therefore, what I mean to say is, please look at language not as something to divide, but as something to unite. That's what I feel, and how language contributes to learning. How language contributes to picking up the culture, that's a very, very important thing. And if I'm good in a couple of languages, I can always pick up other languages. That is what the linguistics say.
No, I understand, Dr. Sridhar, and in fact, I'm completely with you on learning multiple languages, but that's not the point here. I can learn English and Marathi and Tamil and Gujarati and Hindi and Bihari, all of that. And the choice is up to me, three languages, four languages, the more the better. Then we move on to international languages as well, that's fine. But it's about the medium of instruction.
Yes.
If I am somebody who lives in North India, in one state, where I perhaps was taught in Hindi medium, till second standard and then my father gets posted to Maharashtra and then I come here in third standard and suddenly I'm supposed to learn everything in Marathi. When my teacher starts talking to me in Marathi, how will I understand anything?
See, what I feel is the policy very clearly says wherever possible, the medium of instruction until at least grade 5, but preferably till grade 8 and beyond, will be the home language, mother tongue, local language, regional language, wherever possible. Second thing is primarily done keeping into the diversity. And then each state has its own, because education is in the concurrent list. Each state has to take a call and decide. So you cannot think of something which, you know, is equally applicable to the entire country, because you yourself were referring to the diversity, the kind of number of languages. So we need to take a call on that. But the principal point here is multilingualism and contribution to learning. That's what I wanted to emphasize.
Okay, let me bring in our other panelists as well. Anjali Razdan, let's begin with you. What's your view? You know, will this be helpful or harmful for students?
No, there's no question of helpful and harmful. But what you touched upon in the beginning is definitely the point of controversy. It's going to be the medium of instructions. We have nothing against anything, because let a lot of languages be spoken and learnt. There's nothing wrong with that. But if it is a medium of instructions, imagine how many languages do we have, mother tongues particularly. There's something called local language, there's something called mother tongue, there's something called languages spoken at home, which may not be the mother tongue. How many languages are you going to bring in the ambit of teaching? If you see any state, one state if you see, it has at least around 30 to 40 languages, which includes mother tongues as well. So you imagine if people are getting transferred, if children of some parents who are definitely getting transferred, they're going to get taught the mother tongue once, then they may not have the mother tongue in the next state or in the next city. How will that happen? Firstly. Secondly, who's going to teach them? So in every state, every city, you must have teachers ready to teach them the medium of instructions to the mother tongue, which means a school has to have an array of teachers teaching mother tongue and the medium. It looks like a Herculean task, easier said than done. And when we see that point where it is wherever possible, sir had said it, Mrs. said it, wherever possible, that is a little ambiguous, because what do we mean by wherever possible? If it has become impossible by the variety of languages our country has, very rich languages, how do we make it possible for children to move from city to city, state to state? Even now with the present condition, it's difficult. It was difficult rather before the COVID times. But then what's going to happen when it's going to be the medium of instructions?
Mm.
So that's a big point. Mm. If that is sorted out.
Correct.
If that's made or drafted or moderated, yes. Possibly then there's no harm in learning a lot of languages. But mother tongue is one thing.
No, there absolutely. Can be thousands of, yes.
How do you have literature and all that in mother tongue? That's something which we need to have a little idea about. I think then that's, if something is thrown to us, sure, we are going to take it forward.
Yes, no, absolutely. That's what I'm saying. The difference has to be in learning different languages, whereas using something as a medium of instruction to teach. And we have to keep in mind, you will then also need, you know, those many skilled teachers to teach you these subjects in a regional language. But let me bring in Mr. Binoy Viswam, because Mr. Viswam, we understand that there are, you know, this is something that already exists in parts of Kerala. Could you shed some more light? How does it work? Can there be a mid-rural path where the state says, okay, we'll have some schools, but not all, that follow this path?
No, this issue can arise not only in Kerala. In a great and vast country like India, this question can arise everywhere, all along India, south and north, east or west, it can happen. I should say the wrongdoing from the part of the government is quite simple. They simply forget to understand that this is a country of diversity. A country of so many languages, dialects, they forgot it. And in their hurry to come out with this education policy, they even forgot to acknowledge the truth that education is a matter in the concurrent list of the Constitution. And that concurrent list very specifically say that the state has a right on so many issues, and this being a very important issue, the medium of instruction. So the state's opinion was not sought. There was no room for a central government in the country which was in a hurry to do this work. They did not apply their minds to understand how the states view this matter. So no states were consulted. It was not even consulted in the parliament. There was no debate there. There was no opportunity for a number of parliaments belonging to, I belong to the Communist Party of India. Not only my party, there are big parties, bigger parties than my party. MPs from any parties would have something to add to this issues from all sides. And that's the forum to discuss such matters. What right the government has got to deny that right to the parliaments, to deny that right to the states? And now it is natural that this kind of questions can arise. As a matter of principle, I should say that the mother tongue being the medium of instruction up to the fifth standard is a correct thing, not a bad thing. The reasons are obvious, because the maximum grasping capacity to a normal child is definitely in his mother tongue or her mother tongue. His or her mother tongue being the medium of instruction for a small child up to the class of fifth, then preferably up to the eighth standard, I should add, it's a good decision as a matter of principle. But in practical terms, when it comes to the point of implementation, this will raise this kind of questions. And that questions are to be addressed. And that way, I should say that the government
but Mr. Binoy Viswam,
holds.
Of course, this is still left to the states.
One more sentence. So I should request the governments or appeal the governments, please withhold the implementation of the education policy and begin that consultation in the parliament, begin that consultation with the states, and try to find answers and solutions for so many vital issues like this. This is my request to the government as a member of the parliament. Thank you.
Yes, but Mr. Binoy Viswam, as far as this specific aspect is concerned, it's still left to the state governments, we understand, to decide. It's not mandatory by the center as per this policy. It's left to the state governments. In fact, that's what I said initially, that my fear is that every time somebody wants to, as a political party, push through the narrative of regionalism and their own mother tongue, they will propose this without finding a solution for those children and those students who may not know that language, who may not be local to that area, to that language, and then will struggle. Now, Lata Vaidyanathan, is there merit to the concern that many are raising that what happens that if you learn, if you are taught in school in your local language or mother tongue till 8th standard and suddenly in 9th standard, you are expected to grasp the toughest of the physics and chemistry and literature and all of that in English or any other language? Will children be able to then take on that burden? Already, it's the additional syllabus and then the language change.
Okay, so Tanvi, I think I've been listening to Dr. Sridhar and my co-panelists. And I think one thing is coming through very clearly, that for a child as young as 3 years old, the comfort of the mother tongue is not debatable. However, when we look at the complete language policy as is being taught, I think when I went through the policy document, I get a very clear feeling that it begins with saying wherever possible. So it is not as if it's an imposition. It is a decision which says it needs to be encouraged in terms of two and none of this is really new, because for, I think whether it was the 86 policy or even earlier, the three language formula has been there right through. And right, as far as this one small sticky point which we can talk of in terms of whether mother tongue will be made compulsory as a medium of instruction, I think that is the only point. And even there, the policy document actually talks of a bilingual approach to the whole problem, where if the child is not understanding the language in which the instruction is carried out, the school, whether private or public, requires to provide the bilingual support. Now, my worry is something else, not so much because I don't see too much of a conflict, because the whole thing is qualified by saying wherever possible. I think beyond that, we don't need to read it in a very difficult manner as of this moment. Secondly, my real worry is when multilingualism comes up, which is in fact the kids' ability to read and become actually learn so many languages and increase their cognitive abilities, is something we all know of. It's nothing new. My worry really is that in the foundational years, the professional standards for teachers, I'm hoping that by the NPST that is being set up, the national one, in consultation with the NCRT and the SCRT and the school, the SSSA, will actually work out materials which are professionally developed and makes the competence of the teacher actually look into these matters and sort it out at their local levels, at the state levels, rather than make it a national issue. Because at no point in time I'm reading this national policy as imposition of the mother tongue as a medium of instruction. I think it just says wherever possible, with the belief that a child finds it convenient and comfortable to be in their mother tongue. My worry again is with regard to, as you pointed out, children who are moving from state to state with their parents on transfers, or a classroom having children with many languages within themselves, and at that time, who's going to decide what is the national, what is the regional language, or what is the mother tongue? Therefore, in such cases, I think a very clear discussion must happen, a very clear policy understanding must be there as to what is it that will make learning comfortable for children. There should be really no imposition of sorts in any state or otherwise, which makes this issue a little more difficult for people to deal with. And the comfort, while understanding the importance of the regional language, or for that matter, the mother tongue, must be flexible enough for schools to take their own decision. I think it should not be too difficult. It has been happening with tremendous amount of success as of now. I don't think we are finding it very difficult to deal with it as it is now, and therefore the systems will continue. I'm hoping, however, that with the increased amount of teacher training which will be required and handholding that the national NCRT and the SCRTs will do for them, there'll be better material, better training for teachers, and hopefully more investment in the foundational years that will come through to see that whatever is envisaged will be a successful one in terms of the foundational years, which are very critical for the child's growth. Language, to me, doesn't seem to be, as of now, through this document, a bone of contention. That's my limited understanding. And I hope that I'm more correct than everyone who is probably believing that that could become a matter of concern for all.
Okay, thank you so much for, you know, explaining that and sharing your view. I must also reiterate the fact that this is not new. It was existent even in the previous policy, except that, of course, not too many states really took it up. But the fact that it was discussed again this time, and what, you know, has been reported, is that there were some members who wanted to make it Hindi, who wanted the language of instruction and the medium of instruction to be Hindi, is where this conversation happened again, but there were objections, and so it was left to the mother tongue. Before I go back to Dr. Sridhar, comments from Shweta Shalini as well. Is this an option that your party, Shweta Shalini, will want to look at wherever you are in power?
Okay, so thank you, Tanvi, for finally getting me into the debate. When you get me towards the end, I get to answer your question and every panelist's questions as well. So I will start with Binoy ji. He's a member of the CPI, and they've been in power for so many long years, and they have never been able to get any sort of educational reform. Finally, after 30 long years, the country has seen some sort of educational reform. Second, I think what we are seeing on your panel itself is a complete and sad display of Macaulayism, because Lord Macaulay at one point of time used the English colonies for delivering out Babus in English medium, and that's what we see today. And that's why an educationalist like Anjali ji actually said it on national TV that there are no literature in regional languages. What about all those Bangla Sangeet that was written in Bangla, the Marathi, the Tamil literature that has been written? Second, third, and the most important thing to answer your question, Sanjay, 1% of India is in transferable jobs. And please note, I think Lata ji has very, very specifically read, and she is the only person who's read the policy, because it primarily says that there is no imposition. And in fact, there was a clarification today which says that wherever possible, please do this, because in any case, education is a state subject. And just to inform Binoy ji, this education policy was put on the internet, not only for discussion, but 40,000 people commented on it and changes were made. So it's not only you or parties or political parties and states, but also the common people who actually replied to this policy. Last but not the least, I want to practically tell you that the second migration that you talk about is the migratory labors. Now, RTE is made compulsory. These migratory labors, when they move from one state to another state, they in any case, so when somebody moves from Bihar to Maharashtra, they put their children in the Marathi medium schools because that's what they can afford. And the children learn Marathi. So primarily, we are only talking about the transferable job, that is 1 or 2%, for whom Kendra Vidyalaya and central schools are made. And they will definitely ensure that the interests of these people are taken care of. Last but not the least, please go back and check all the countries where local languages have been promoted. Look at China. They have a search engine called Baidu. Look at Russia. The Yandex, which is their search engine, is valued $18 billion. Why? Because the children focus not only on language, but they focus on the subject in itself, and that's how research and technology gets benefited. We want to create innovators and no more babus. And that is why anybody who wants to learn any other languages, there are people in India who are learning German, there are people in India who are learning French, and it's open to all. Because yes, as Lata ji rightly said, it increases the cognizance of child. But then you need to understand that the subject, sometimes it so happens that the young child who comes from an economic backward class cannot focus on the subject itself or the understanding of the subject because he's so focused on the language. And that is where the problem lies. And that is where the new education policy says, on the prerogative of the state can decide that the medium of instruction can be bilingual, which means it could be the local language as so a second language.
So why haven't you done it so far if you so strongly believe in it? It already, the proposal and the provision already exists.
Tanvi, yes, can I just say something?
The implementation, Tanvi ji, is with the state because state education is a state subject. Now the policy has come out and it has left to the state to ensure right implementation. Yes, if you would have had a debate on
No, Shweta Shalini, you didn't understand the policy. The policy was there in the previous document as well. And since then, BJP has been in power in many, many states for many, many years.
Yes,
why didn't you implement it then?
I told you that it was given for public domain and suggestions for the past 1 year. We have been wanting to get this into implementation.
No.
And that's what we will do.
Tanvi, can I intervene?
No, this was there in the 1986 policy for 34 years. Yes, Lata Vaidyanathan, yeah. Go ahead, please, and then across.
Yeah.
Then we'll go to Mr. Viswam. Yes, Lata Vaidyanathan first.
No. I'm only saying this, that, you know, there has been a structural change as far as the first 5 years are concerned. And that is a very critical period to be led beautifully for all children. That is a place where change has actually happened. And when we are integrating them either in as standalone schools or as parts of the senior schools, I have a concern that this language issue, and unlike some other countries which my predecessor has just spoken about, I think we have close to 22 languages in this country and very beautifully linked to the culture of this country. There is no debate that such languages must not be learned or otherwise. My only concern, and I like the policy to the extent that, you know, they have said wherever possible. So there is a certain amount of freedom given. I think the states will take cognizance of all of these.
Okay.
And without really forgetting, however,
yes,
that any language need not be blamed for the current circumstances. And I think we as a very progressive country and looking very well into the future need to be completely equipped with all languages and its strengths, inclusive of English, to make sure that the window of opportunities are not missed out by anybody. Be it science, and I one would be the happiest to know that all children have access to the best education and language of their choice. And if I think this concerns of the parents, that if it is taught in English, it will not be understood, or if it is taught in Hindi, it will not be understood, I think needs to be addressed. Where language development in each of the languages must see the light of the day in terms of their technical language ability and the ability in which it is rendered. Do we have the capacity of so many teachers actually rendering this education in all languages with the same impact as it is supposed to do? So I think we need to focus on those areas rather than worry about the imposition, which doesn't seem to be a part of this policy. I think NCRT and the entire...
But it has gotten many schools and many... It has gotten, Ms. Radhanathan, many schools and many parents worried, which is why it is essential to have this conversation. Very quickly, if I can get a clarification from Dr. Sridhar on that policy. Dr. Sridhar, Dr. Sridhar, when you say in the policy, wherever feasible we should do this, what does that mean? What's the criteria for feasibility to decide that the language of the medium of instruction should be the local language?
See, one thing, Tanvi, what I would like to say is any policy for the entire country is a matter of direction and vision. I think this very important point that we need to keep in mind. No policy can get into operational details. No policy can get into definition of terms. And no policy can get into some of these things. So my only request is, no doubt there are any number of things in the policy. My only small appeal, humble appeal, that it is an opportunity for all of us to lift our education and to help our students, young people. I think if we can slightly make for example, if there are some challenges in implementation, we need to address them. We need to look into them. Whatever is possible, we need to do it. We are not saying that, you know, they are dismissible. No, the points what some of you raised, they're very, very genuine. We need to consider definitely. But my only request is, in the process of doing this, we should not miss the big bus, the big opportunity. So that window of opportunity is available to us.
Yes, I completely agree with you.
That is what my appeal is. Thank you.
In fact, Dr. Sridhar, I find many parts of this policy, as you said, you know, it's more to lay out the path, lay out a vision, and then implementation, of course, is where it will really matter. But I did find a lot of parts of this policy which were extremely progressive and helpful, and I hope that actually it gets implemented sooner than later, especially in the changes of structure, the kind of education, the holistic approach that we're talking, lesser focus on exams and the rote learning system that has come into seeped into our system so deeply. So I do appreciate that fact. Anjali Razdan wanted to come in, perhaps wanted to respond to what Shweta Chandni said. Go ahead, Anjali Razdan.
I wanted to respond to Shweta ji. It's nothing, I think we did not politicize the whole thing. It's about a language, and we are very, very happy with the languages coming in, and there's nothing wrong with different languages being taught and spoken. I am talking about the nitty-gritties that will happen once it has to be implemented. I do presume that it is only a policy right now, and it's going to have a lot of methods and, you know, rules and regulations to govern them, and it's going to then get implemented. It's going to take a lot of time and more debates and all that. But at the very initial level I'm talking about, at the very peripheral level, when it says wherever possible, there will be people and states and cities who may say it's not possible. Or it is possible. How do you say it's possible? So when you leave it as vague as that, wherever possible, That's where the whole problem starts. And it amounts to a huge amount of, as we say, teacher training. I'm going to only on those areas. I'm not going to debate on whether it's good or bad. It's definitely very good to have different languages. But when you're comparing China and all other countries, they're just one language, or maybe two. For us, one state is bigger than China in terms of languages, or US, or whatever you call it. One state, one city has hundreds of sub-languages and mother tongues. When we say Maharashtra, we don't mean only Marathi. There are 10,000 languages in Maharashtra, which are mother tongues. Again, there is Konkani, there is this. What can you do for that? How do you justify?
Please understand this. 20% of India speaks English. 80% speak their own different languages. So I understand that. But please also understand that there are so many schools. Every corner of a road has a school. What stops you from having one school for a particular language? And this implementation is something which is in the prerogative of the state and the city and the authority, local authorities, according to the demand. What the policy says is stop thinking like babus. Let's focus on subjects. Let's focus on the fact that there is a lot of pride in your own mother tongue. And that's precisely what I pointed out. I'm sorry if I... You know, I didn't mean to.
I don't know why you're linking it, Shweta Shalini, to pride. Please, I don't know why you're linking it to pride. Nobody is denying the pride in knowing your own mother tongue and using your mother tongue. That doesn't mean the pride doesn't have to come by saying that it has to be used as a medium of instruction to teach everything else. There is no denying the fact. We love each and every single language in our country. You should teach your mother tongue. Yes, of course you should. But what happens? What happens? 1 minute now. 1 minute. What happens when I suddenly?
After you. The way the panel is structured.
Thank you. My only point is this: what happens when in 9th standard suddenly my science splits into three different segments? The theorems, the formulae, the concepts get more and more difficult. The wordings get more difficult. And I don't even know the proper English terms for half of them, because so far I was learning it in another language. And now not only does English become the most important thing, because I'm learning my math, my difficult science in English, where I don't know half of these words, suddenly I have to get the best in English and then have the added burden of what I'm learning in maths or in physics or in chemistry or in social science, in history, in geography. Suddenly I'm supposed to know these terms in English. How will you deal with that added burden? It's very easy to say that in other countries it happens, because in other countries, there are only two languages to understand. Here we have so many languages. So that has to be kept in mind when you design this plan.
These are all realities, how our country, how our society, all that is reality. Now you please tell me, is there any possibility of one single solution for the entire country?
No, there isn't.
So therefore, we need to work under a situation, under the circumstances, under the realities. So that is a challenge. So if there is a diversity...
So why change it? Why change the language at all? Then let's go all the way and say all the way through school you study in the same mother tongue. Does our pride suddenly end by class 5th or 8th?
Precisely what we are saying.
No, please try to understand. See, I am not getting into other things. I am only trying to say, putting a point, if there is a diversity, there is a challenge with that we need to address. So there is no point in again and again saying that there is so many languages, etc. That all of us know. We have lived for ages.
Okay.
So therefore, how to address it?
Can I come in, Tanvi?
I appreciate that point. I appreciate that point that you say that there is a challenge that all of us have to address. I'm sorry I'm interrupting, but I'm completely out of time, and I do want to give at least the last 1 minute to Mr. Binoy Viswam, who has been wanting to make a point. Yes, Mr. Viswam, over to you before I wrap.
My only point is this. I told in the beginning itself, though I have differences with this policy on so many aspects, I agree with the concept that the mother tongue should be the medium of instruction up to the level of fifth standard. It's a welcome step in the policy, no doubt. And mother tongue has its own significant source. But my only reservation is this. While we talk about it in a policy is something serious. It's true, my friend from the BJP was telling here about the public domain and the 40,000 suggestions came from the public. That's true. But remember, this is the country where the maximum number of people are still illiterate in this country, in the Wales, even today. And in this country, where there is a big divide of digital divide is there. Digital haves and digital have-nots are a reality here. In such a country, the public domain is a beautiful word. But that word has only limited meaning in the Indian context. So my only point is that when we talk about the sensitive issues like language and the medium of instruction and the matters, very importantly, like the education policy, the government should have a patience and a courtesy and a feeling of democratic values to consult every people who have a stake in this matter. The states are having the stakes.
Okay, that's the another matter. That's fair enough. Many opposition parties are upset that this was not debated in the parliament at all. But let me just say this, Mr. Viswam. This is just, if it helps, this is a vision document. It's a larger thought process for what should happen over the next 15 years. Yeah. It's not going to happen overnight. You will have a lot of chance to actually discuss and debate each single policy and aspect of it in the coming years. That much I'm very sure of. But I am going to wrap at this point and thank all of our panelists. Thank you so much for joining us on this conversation. We'll have lots more. It's an exhaustive policy document. Many, many aspects to touch upon and we'll continue to do that. But a big thank you to the panelists who've joined us right now. And without wasting any more time, I actually want to quickly move on and go across to our very special guest who's joining us right now. And we continue with the focus on the national education policy. And joining me right now is the education minister, is the deputy chief minister of the national capital, Mr. Manish Sisodia, who's actually very closely been dealing with the schools in the national capital, the government schools, and has a great personal interest in education as well. Mr. Sisodia, thank you for speaking with us. We all heard what you had to say yesterday, the few issues that you raised, and I want to follow up on those issues. But before we do that, let me first ask you, are there any aspects of this policy that excite you, that you're actually impressed with and happy about?
Certainly, there are two, three things which are new and was much needed, like introduction of early childhood education into the mainframe of the education system. That's a very important step, but there is no roadmap for that. That's the sad part of it. Choice options for subjects for students at a school level is a good mother tongue. Foundation education in mother tongue, I personally feel, is a good step, progressive step. There are certain steps that are good, but the problem is ki all this policy is set of very good articulated, well-articulated concept of education are compiled here. But how those will be implemented, where would the money come from, how much time it will take, when, what will start when, there is no time frame, there is no legal framework that would be required for this. There is nothing that makes mandatory to be done. So those are key missing points which will make this document a very good, wishful thinking, progressive document without any roadmap.
Well, if this is a good vision document, then what aspects would you implement and how would you go about implementing those?
I think all these things are already there in the visions. We had national curriculum framework, we have a 1986 policy, we have 1966 policy, which have been talking about all good things that are being talked about education at that point of time, and we have here also. The problem is in 1966, we spoke, our policy, national policy spoke about 6% of GDP should be spent on education. We have not it mandatory since then. हेयर ऑल्सो वी एच एफ स्पोकिन, ये कहती है हम राज्य सरकारों के साथ बात करेंगे इस पे करने के लिए. कैसे करोगे जी? आप देश के लिए कानून बनाइए, मेक ए लॉ फॉर दैट, देन ओनली इट कैन बी डन. इफ यू डोंट मेक ए लॉ, इट कांट हैपन. 66 से आज तक नहीं हुआ, आगे भी 66 तक नहीं होगा.
Mr. Sisodia, before I go to the other crucial parts, I wanted to ask you, because you raised the point about regional languages, and that was just a debate we were having right now. What about the exceptions? You know, what about even if there are a small percentage of people who are in places where the local language is not their mother tongue, how will they then, you know, what about those parents and those children?
There are certainly exceptions for this, and there are certainly arrangements. We have to think for masses and exceptions both. Internationally, we have seen that when you come to masses, you should think of mass approaches. That's very important. दुनिया भर में जहाँ भी ऐसा हुआ है, medium of instructions लोगों ने अपनी mother tongue में, local languages में लिए हैं, foundation level तक, वहाँ बच्चों की progress बहुत तेज़ी से हुई है. Exceptions की जहाँ तक आपने बात की कि transferable jobs हैं, इधर उधर जाना होगा, वहाँ भी मुझे लगता है उसके भी roots हैं. एक देश से दूसरे देश में भी लोग जाते ही हैं और वहाँ भी अपने बच्चों को पढ़ाते ही हैं, और वहाँ उसके लिए एक्सेप्शंस, उसके लिए व्यवस्थाएं हैं, वो व्यवस्थाएं अभी भी की जा सकती हैं. बट जहाँ आप देश के 80 करोड़ बच्चों को, 80 लाख बच्चों को एजुकेशन दे रहे हैं, वो एक बड़ी क्वांटिटी है, और उसमें आप उनकी फाउंडेशन को मजबूत करने के लिए अगर आप 5 साल उनको मदर टंग में पढ़ना सिखाना, उनकी एक्टिविटी करना सिखाते हो, उसके बाद लैंग्वेजेस सीखना उसके लिए बाएं हाथ का खेल होगा.
Okay, fair enough, but there are also experts and many have this concern, parents also have this concern. What happens after fifth grade 5 or grade 8 when suddenly not only has your syllabus increased, but you also have to learn it in a language that you are not that proficient in?
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल ज़रूरत नहीं है, बिल्कुल उसकी ज़रूरत भी नहीं है. सिक्स्थ ग्रेड ऑनवर्ड आप इंग्लिश या और कोई लैंग्वेज में मीडियम ऑफ इंस्ट्रक्शंस भी ले सकते हैं. आज भी दिल्ली में बहुत अच्छे अच्छे गवर्नमेंट और प्राइवेट स्कूल्स हैं जो फिफ्थ ग्रेड तक इंग्लिश को मैंडेटरी नहीं करते हैं. वहाँ सेमी इंग्लिश, हिंदी, मिक्स उर्दू, मिक्स पंजाबी, मिक्स इस तरह की भाषा में पढ़ाई होती है जो मीडियम ऑफ इंस्ट्रक्शंस है. उसके बाद सिक्स क्लास से वो अपना प्रोफेशनल डेवलपमेंट करते हैं. मैं नाम नहीं लेना चाहता, बट दिल्ली के सबसे प्रोग्रेसिव स्कूल्स में वो स्कूल माने जाते हैं आज की तारीख में, और उनकी सबसे बड़ी तारीफ यही है कि उन्होंने अपने बच्चों का शुरू का जो 5-6 साल का पीरियड था उसको समझ विकसित करने में, उसकी ग्रोथ में, मेंटल ग्रोथ में उसको यूज़ किया, और उसके बाद में उनकी सब्जेक्टिव नॉलेज सिक्स क्लास ऑनवर्ड दी. और ये दुनिया भर में भी, मैं आपको बताऊँ, बहुत सफल प्रयोग इसके हुए हैं, स्टडीज हुई हैं कि जो बच्चा फिफ्थ क्लास तक अपनी मदर टंग में सीखता है, और एक बच्चा जिसने मदर टंग की जगह किसी और फॉरेन लैंग्वेज में या किसी और लैंग्वेज में इंस्ट्रक्शंस ली, उसके बाद 4-5 साल बाद जब उनकी स्टडी की गई तो ये देखा गया कि दोनों, वो फॉरेन लैंग्वेज पे दोनों की कमांड बराबर थी.
Okay, let's move on. The other one important aspect, Mr. Sisodia, is the private education part. Isme, not just that, in terms of opening up the sector, ek policy ka part uspe hai ki foreign universities yahan pe aake set up ho sakti hai, aur dusra hai private sector ko involve karna. Now, you have raised, expressed some concerns about increasing the private sector involvement. Why is that? Why are you, so opposed to it?
पब्लिक एजुकेशन का हाल बहुत ख़राब है पूरे देश में, और इस पॉलिसी में सरकार उस अपनी जिम्मेदारी से भागती हुई दिख रही है. सरकार बल्कि खुल के कह रही है कि हम प्राइवेट एजुकेशन को एंकरेज करेंगे. इसका मतलब क्या हुआ? इसका मतलब यह है कि आप सरकार ये कह रही है कि नई एजुकेशन पॉलिसी में हम प्राइवेट एजुकेशन को बढ़ावा देंगे. सरकार स्कूल नहीं चला सकती है, सरकार स्कूल इंप्रूव नहीं कर सकती है, इसलिए हम प्राइवेट एजुकेशन को बढ़ावा देंगे. बहुत सैड पार्ट है. फॉरेन यूनिवर्सिटीज, आई वुड से कि फॉरेन यूनिवर्सिटीज़ को सिर्फ प्राइवेटाइजेशन से नहीं देखा जाना चाहिए. अगर आज दिल्ली के DTU के साथ MIT का कोई गठन होता है, एक नए कोर्सेज शुरू होते हैं, उससे हमारे देश में बच्चों को और टैलेंट लेने की अपॉर्चुनिटीज़ मिलेंगी. ये एक अच्छा कदम है. लेकिन स्कूल लेवल पर प्राइवेट सिस्टम को बढ़ावा देना, ये अनफॉर्चुनेट है. फॉरेन यूनिवर्सिटीज़ को इनवाइट करके नई यूनिवर्सिटीज़ खोलना, या नेशनल यूनिवर्सिटीज़ के साथ में, या जो हमारी स्टेट यूनिवर्सिटीज़ हैं उनके साथ उनके टाई अप कराना, ये एक अच्छा कदम होगा.
बट यही तो मैं भी कह रही हूँ, पब्लिक स्कूल्स की इतनी हालत ख़राब है हमारे देश में, और अगर आप कह रहे हैं कि गवर्नमेंट स्ट्रगल कर रही है, और ऐसा लगता है ये डिसीजन से कि वो मान भी रहे हैं कि उनकी की प्रॉब्लम है, तो क्या बुराई है फिर ले आते हैं प्राइवेट सेक्टर को, क्योंकि गवर्नमेंट से तो हो नहीं रहा.
तो इसका मतलब फिर देश के सारे बच्चों को आप प्राइवेट स्कूल पे पढ़ने के लिए छोड़ देंगे, प्राइवेट स्कूल्स तो फीस करेंगे, इसका मतलब आप एक तरह से एजुकेशन को प्राइवेटाइज करने की तरफ बढ़ रहे हो, दिस इज अनफॉर्चुनेट। दे ये कोई फैसिलिटी नहीं है, आप देश के निर्माण का काम कर रहे हो एजुकेशन के जरिए। ये सरकार इस देश में शिक्षा को फंडामेंटल राइट बताया गया है, आप फंडामेंटल राइट को लेने के लिए आप कह रहे हो कि आप प्राइवेट से जाके ले लो, ये तो फेलियर है। आप फेलियर एक्सेप्ट कर रहे हो और आप बहुत ब्लंटली आप कह भी रहे हो कि हम अपने हम फेल होंगे और हम कहते रहे हम फेल ही होते रहेंगे।
ओके फेयर इनफ। एक अदर जो पॉइंट है जिसमें डिस्कस करना था मुझे आपसे, वो आपने बोला कि दिस पॉलिसी इज अनेबल टू ब्रेक अवे फ्रॉम द ट्रेडिशनल सिस्टम। नाउ व्हाई डू यू से दैट मिस्टर सिसोदिया? बिकॉज इफ यू लुक एट दैट पॉलिसी, दे आर टॉकिंग अबाउट चेंजिंग द बोर्ड एग्जाम स्ट्रक्चर, दे आर टॉकिंग अबाउट चेंजिंग द ओवरऑल स्ट्रक्चर यू नो फ्रॉम 10+2 टू अ न्यूअर फॉर्मेट, दे आर टॉकिंग अबाउट ब्रिंगिंग इन मोर टेक्नोलॉजी, बैगलेस डेज, यूज ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी फॉर इम्पार्टिंग एजुकेशन। इज इन दिस ऑल ऑफ
this non-traditional? You see, using good words is always good, but how to implement is very important. ये पॉलिसी कहती है कि नहीं साहब बोर्ड एग्जाम तो होगा। आज दुनिया के प्रोग्रेसिव कंट्रीज में टर्म एंड एग्जाम्स जो होते हैं, ईयर एंड एग्जाम्स होते हैं, उनको खत्म कर दिया गया है, वो कंटिन्यूस इवेल्यूशन पे चले गए हैं। आज अमेरिका, यूरोप कंट्री कह लो, आप इंडियन कंट्रीज मतलब एशियन कंट्रीज में भी देख लीजिए, बहुत सारे इंडियन, अब हमारे अंबेडकर यूनिवर्सिटी है दिल्ली में, हमने सेटअप की है, वो भी जितने भी प्रोग्रेसिव एजुकेशन इंस्टीट्यूशंस हैं या सिस्टम्स हैं, वो टर्म एंड एग्जाम की जगह, एक ईयर एंड एग्जामिनेशन की जगह कंटिन्यूस इवेल्यूशन पर बढ़ रहे हैं। और हम कह रहे हैं नहीं नहीं बोर्ड एग्जाम तो होगा। ये जो बोर्ड का फोबिया है, बोर्ड के साथ रिजिडनेस है, नहीं साहब बच्चा जो पूरे साल पढ़ेगा हम साल के अंत में बिठा के तीन घंटे उसका एग्जाम तो लेंगे और हम तब बताएंगे इसने एक साल में कुछ सीखा कि नहीं सीखा, ये सबसे बहुत ऑर्थोडॉक्स सिस्टम है इवेल्युएशन का। आप इसको मानिए कि ये पूरे के पूरे एजुकेशन सिस्टम की, इंडियन एजुकेशन सिस्टम की सबसे बड़ी खामी है कि हम साल के अंत में तीन घंटे बिठा के बच्चे का एग्जाम लेना चाहते हैं, उसके बेस पे कहीं इवेल्युएशन नहीं होता है। अब
You also have a fear that this is highly regulated, the kind of vision that has been put out, too many entities, there is a danger of highly regulated. Can you explain that?
There are certain new entities are also being introduced. Ye keh rahe hain ki jo अब जैसे हमने बोर्ड की बात की, ये कह रहे हैं पहले तो एक बोर्ड एग्जाम होगा, फिर हर बच्चे के लिए एग्जाम लेने के लिए उसकी नेशनल टेस्टिंग एजेंसी होगी, तो बच्चा एग्जाम ही देता रहेगा। फिर ये कह रहे हैं स्कूल के लिए एक एजुकेशन डिपार्टमेंट होगा जो पॉलिसी बनाया करेगा, डायरेक्टरेट ऑफ एजुकेशन सरकारी स्कूल चलाएगा, प्राइवेट स्कूलों को रेगुलेट करने के लिए एक अलग से बॉडी बनाई जाएगी। तो ये नई नई बॉडीज बना के आप क्या करोगे? आप देश के एजुकेशन का प्रोफेशनलाइजेशन कीजिए, प्रोफेशनल्स को लाने की उसमें कोशिश करिए। ये नई नई बॉडीज बना के, नई नई रेगुलेटरी बॉडीज बना के, ये आप कितना रेगुलेट करोगे? आप स्कूल्स को एम्पावर करिए, आप टीचर्स को एम्पावर करिए। आप नई संस्थाएं बना के सोच रहे हैं हम नए रेगुलेटर इस स्कूल के ऊपर खड़ा कर देंगे और वो उसको रेगुलेट करके स्कूल को अच्छा कर देंगे, ये तो और बोर हो जाएगा। हमने हर चीज में रेगुलेटर्स खड़ा कर करके देख लिया है ना देश में, जहां जहां हमने रेगुलेटर्स खड़ा किए वो सारे सिस्टम्स बैठते चले गए।
Let me ask you this, because you know a lot is said and appreciated about the way your government has handled education in the national capital. Anything that you tried there that you believe can now be replicated at a national level?
National level par aaj sabse pehle to zarurat isi baat ki hai ki hum nationally commit kare apne aap ko ki hum education pe paisa kharch karenge. Agar hum ye nahi karenge to fir hum jo kuch bhi sochenge wo sapne hain, khayali pulav hain. तो पहली चीज़ तो मैं देखना चाहता था कि एजुकेशन को, पैसे को कमिटमेंट, फर्मनेस आया उसमें एम्बिग्यूटी नहीं होनी चाहिए, हम बात करेंगे राज्यों से, पहली चीज़ ये। दूसरा, प्रोफेशनल्स को स्पेस मिलना बहुत ज़रूरी है। आज डायरेक्टर एजुकेशन एक आईएएस ऑफिसर होता है, आईएएस ऑफिसर का एक अपना टैलेंट है, लेकिन देश में ज़रूरत इस बात की है कि डायरेक्टर एजुकेशन, देश भर में 29-30 डायरेक्टर ऑफ एजुकेशन हैं, सबके सब प्रोफेशनल्स होने चाहिए। किसी उनको 25-30 साल का स्कूल चलाने का, प्रिंसिपल का, स्कूल पे पॉलिसीज बनाने का, एजुकेशन पे काम करने का एक्सपीरियंस होना चाहिए। कल जो व्यक्ति चाइल्ड वेलफेयर में था, परसों कोल में था, तरसों वो एसडीएम या डीएम है, उसके बीच में आके डायरेक्टर एजुकेशन बन गया, फिर दो साल बाद उसको, क्योंकि दो साल में टेन्योर पूरा हो जाएगा, उसको उठा के आप हेल्थ सेक्रेटरी बना दोगे। तो ये जो सिस्टम्स हैं, मुझे लगता है ये खामी है देश के एजुकेशन सिस्टम में। एजुकेशन सिस्टम को प्रोफेशनल्स को चलाने के लिए हमें स्पेस क्रिएट करना चाहिए था, और मैं उम्मीद कर रहा था कि प्रोफेशनल्स को खूब जगह मिलेगी, लेकिन वही बोर्ड, वही नई अथॉरिटीज, वही नए रेगुलेटर्स, इससे तो कुछ नहीं होने वाला।
Since I have you with me, Mrs. Sisodia, I want to ask you, education has been one of those sectors badly hit because of coronavirus and the lockdown. What is the Delhi government's plan, you know, a backup plan? What are you thinking right now? Because the way the situation is, it doesn't seem like the schools will open for the next few months.
It seems like a school will be shut for a few more months, yes. Central government has given new guidelines where at least till 31st August we are closed. So Delhi government has approached to students on a semi-online pattern. When I say semi-online means certain things are available online, but there are certain students who are not approachable online, so we are approaching them in person. We are allowing them to come to school, take the study material, go back. Now our teachers are, that's very small segment, our teachers are contacting them in person, they are on phone, they are instructing them on phone, they are asking their submissions in person. So सेमी ऑनलाइन सिस्टम हमने दिल्ली में लागू किया है एंड आई एम टेकिंग रिव्यू इन ईच डिस्ट्रिक्ट एवरी डे आई गो टू वन डिस्ट्रिक्ट एंड टेक ए रिव्यू विद स्टूडेंट्स पेरेंट्स ऑनलाइन आई एम टेकिंग लॉट ऑफ रिव्यूज आई एम फाइंडिंग दिस वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग दैट पेरेंट्स आर अडॉप्टिंग विद दिस पेरेंट्स आर सेइंग कि हाँ अभी हमारे बच्चों को कम से कम नुकसान होगा कोरोना के पीरियड में ये हम कॉन्फिडेंट हैं.
That's very interesting. You say that there is a one-on-one interaction that's happening between the teachers and the students, especially those who don't have access to, you know, a proper online system. Do they communicate on WhatsApp? Are there special videos that are made to teach children then? And did you have to train the teachers in this?
We have given trainings to our teachers because WhatsApp, social media, aaj sab use karte hi hain. Teachers ko padhana pehle se aata hi hai. Bas unko एक थोड़ा कैसे स्ट्रीमलाइन करके हमने कुछ उसके स्टैंडर्ड ऑपरेटिंग प्रोसीजर्स बता दिए कैसे इसको इम्प्लीमेंट करेंगे हमारे एक्सपर्ट्स बहुत सारे हमने उसको जोड़ दिए जिन टीचर्स को थोड़ा पुराने टीचर्स हैं जिनको व्हाट्सएप और सोशल मीडिया और इन सब पे थोड़ा सा कंसर्न थे उनको सिखा दिया. बाकी देखिए टीचर को बेसिकली पढ़ाना आता है आपको उसको सिर्फ फैसिलिटी से जोड़ना है वो हमने जोड़ा है.
मुझे लगता है एक नया बड़ा चैलेंज उनके लिए हो गया है. वैसे ही क्लास में बच्चों को डिसिप्लिन करना कभी कभी मुश्किल हो जाता है टू की मेक देम यू नो कीप क्वाइट. इमेजिन दैट चैलेंज नाउ ऑन लैपटॉप डिजिटली म्यूट नहीं कर रहे हैं बात नहीं सुन रहे तो ये एक बड़ा चैलेंज हो गया होगा टीचर्स के लिए.
चैलेंजेस इट्स अ टफ टाइम एंड वी ऑल आर पासिंग थ्रू एक्स्ट्राऑर्डिनरी टाइम्स सो देयर आर एक्स्ट्राऑर्डिनरी स्टेप्स दैट वी हैव टू टेक.
Fair enough, Mr. Sisodia. Thank you so much for joining us today and for this conversation on, you know, the education sector from the national policy, of course, to the fact that, you know, how you're dealing with the COVID situation. Thank you for giving us your time.